With the Halloween weekend ahead, the Office of Multicultural and Global Education is pushing for awareness when it comes to costume choices.
And public safety takes a serious approach to training in case of an emergency.
All that and more coming up on the Q30 Newscast.
This is the Q30 News Nightcast.
Hello and welcome to the Q30 Newscast. I'm Brenna Oricoli.
And I'm Zach Blanchard.
After recent school shooting threats in the United States, Quinnipiac's public safety hosted the first ever training sessions for students in case of an active shooter.
Q30's Jenelle Cadigan has a story about how the university is preparing for the worst.
Over the last couple of months, the threat of active shootings has put the nation in a state of constant fear. In the last 2 years alone, there have been over 150 shooting incidents in the U.S., and the numbers are still climbing. Prior to this week, Quinnipiac has never had an official active shooter procedure, nor have they taught the students or professors what to do in the event of an armed intruder on campus. However, on Monday, the Executive Vice President, Mark Thompson, sent an email to the university community stating the newly implemented protocol. In addition, the email listed training sessions, which, for the first time, are open to students, faculty, and staff. Chief of Public Safety Edgar Rodriguez says the feedback has been nothing but positive, and he also explained the university's two-part goal.
Yeah, we've never had something in place, so this is going to be a work in progress. We started putting together an emergency evacuation plan for the university and an emergency management plan for the university. And out of that came the training part of it. Our goal was to train public safety just in case, God forbid, something happened, so our people knew what they needed to do. And the second part of this is now to train and awareness training for student, faculty, and staff.
The active shooter awareness training sessions include a PowerPoint presentation and simulation video, as well as a Q&A. One student veteran asked why the university can't change its gun policy to allow students or professors to use their own registered guns when defending against a shooter.
Why not change that?
I can tell you that. I think we got to leave that to law enforcement. That's number one. Number two, okay. We don't know who's trained and who's not trained. We don't want a bunch of people running around on campus with weapons on them, you know, scaring people away or forcing situations. So at this point in time, I think we want to leave it to law enforcement to handle that.
What do you estimate would be the time of arrival from the time the active shooting first 911 dispatch call to the time your first officer or SRT or response team shows up on scene?
Minutes.
Minutes?
Minutes.
Minutes is a long time.
Minutes.
Quinnipiac University decided last year to add armed public safety officers to their staff. While these staff members are allowed to carry weapons on campus, page 67 of the student handbook states that possession, storage, transportation, or use of a firearm or other dangerous weapon is prohibited on campus.
Without things like metal detectors or other scanning equipment, how does Quinnipiac know the only people bringing guns onto this campus are the 28 permitted armed officers?
Right now it's on an honor system. I mean, we not only students, but faculty and staff. In the employee handbook, there's something that says that you're not allowed to have any weapons on campus. So right now, that's what the policy is, and we hope that everybody's respecting that.
While public safety trusts people on campus are following these instructions, Rodriguez says his department plans to follow up these training sessions with a test.
Our goal is to conduct at least two drills during each semester, so that people get familiar with what's going on and what to do in a case of an emergency or a case of an active shooter incident. It's the only way we're going to do it. If we don't practice a plan, you can tell people all day long, this is what you need to do, but if they don't practice it, they won't do it.
Jenelle Cadigan, Q30 News.
In SGA's latest campaign to get students out to vote in Hamden's mayoral election, they hosted a kickoff registration event on Monday. 150 students came out to register, and SGA members brought the forms to Town Hall on Tuesday. All students can now vote in the upcoming election. Student body president Johnny Atkin is urging students to realize that they can, in fact, vote in the town.
Holocaust survivor Anita Ron Shore came to Quinnipiac to discuss her experiences. Shore's lecture is part of the Anti-Defamation Program
Echoes and Reflections Holocaust Educator Program. Shore is a native of Czechoslovakia and is one of the youngest Holocaust survivors alive today. After both her parents and brothers were killed in the Holocaust, Shore fought in the Israeli War of Independence and went on to start a new life in the United States. This is the fourth time Shore has spoken at Quinnipiac. And with Halloween fast approaching, Hamden plans on making sure all students are safe through a list of safety precautions. Q30's Victoria Saha takes a look.
Quinnipiac is gearing up for a spooky and safe Halloween weekend. A few students talked to Q30 about the specific measures they would be taking to ensure a safe weekend. How are you planning on staying safe this weekend?
Seeing as I'm a girl, I'm going to stay in groups this weekend, and all my roommates, we have like a group costume that we're going to do. So I think if we stick together like that, we'll all stay pretty safe.
Probably hanging out with my friends and I guess, I don't know, staying in a group, you know, not wandering off.
How do you think public safety should handle this festive weekend?
I'm not really sure. Maybe they should just like double up on like the buses or something. Maybe be more out the New Haven area, like where the buses are. They should definitely have more of them there. But I don't know. I think they're doing a great job like every weekend. So the best they can do is just have more people out there.
Most of our students agree that they would feel safer sticking with a bigger crowd. For Q30 News, I'm Victoria Saha.
Quinnipiac is continuing its efforts to help make sure everyone's Halloween costumes are as inclusive as possible. Q30's Michael Brennan has the story.
For the second year in a row, Quinnipiac is going to make you think twice about what costumes to wear for Halloween this year.
Sade Jean-Jacques, the Assistant Director of Multicultural Education, hopes the campaign will educate students who may not realize who they hurt with their costumes.
Fun doesn't necessarily have to equate to being offensive, and a lot of times it's not things that are intentional, just folks are not aware how some of these costumes could be perceived.
Many students had heard of the movement after two emails were sent to the student body briefly explaining its position. The posters featured in the emails show people in stereotypical outfits with people of the corresponding race looking at them with shame.
Take a look at this poster featuring a young woman in a tribal outfit, or this man in a sombrero and mustache while a group of Latin Americans feels highly uncomfortable.
Some students are positive about the campaign, such as senior Sophie Bradburn, who thinks students should be more sensitive to other people's cultures.
Anything that has cultural significance to somebody shouldn't be worn as just a costume. Like, it's not something that's just decorative.
Sophomore Gregory Terzis, however, thinks that the campaign is bad because he doesn't think anybody is being intentionally mean when they're wearing their costumes, and thus the campaign is pointless.
It's really not an issue because if it was an issue and people were actually being racist, then that would be an issue. You don't see people like walking around with Confederate flag hats.
But Jean-Jacques hopes students will understand that discrimination still exists and sympathize with the experiences of other students.
Racism exists, sexism exists, heterosexism exists. All of these things are real, and until we acknowledge that, we won't really be able to fully understand or, you know, understand as best as we can the experiences of our students that are coming through our doors.
Reporting for the Q30 Newscast, I'm Michael Brennan.
Still to come on the Q30 Newscast, alumni were welcomed back to campus for the weekend.
And Dora Labatt has your full weather forecast. Dora, what can we expect?
Ugh, a lot of rain today. Well, at least that's all for the hurricanes in the Northeast, but as for the rain, not so much. Stay tuned for your full weather forecast. We'll be right back.
I could really go for a Ray and Mike's sub right now.
Come to Ray and Mike's and try our Philly chicken and cheese for just over $4. Giant cheesesteak subs and mouth-watering boar's head sandwiches for as low as $4.75. Qcash accepted, just a mile down the road on Whitney, here at Ray and Mike's.
QU turned Hogwarts Saturday for Chi Omega's Quidditch on the quad event. Students in teams of six competed with all of the necessary equipment, yes, even the brooms. The Day of Magic and Wizardry also included other fun activities and a bake sale with Potter-themed treats. All proceeds went to benefit the sorority's philanthropy, the Make-A-Wish Foundation. And more than just bludgers were thrown on the quad this weekend. Alpha Chi Omega hosted their annual Frisbee Fest. The event was complete with an ultimate Frisbee competition and the famous Pi and Alpha Chi. All of this in honor of those who suffered from domestic violence. The money raised went to the Shelter for Domestic Violence Victims in New Haven.
Many Quinnipiac students have been generating free student tickets online and
with
selling them for cash.
Full swing,
Q30's Kayla Heavey spoke with students about the troubles of having to buy what would have been a free ticket.
With hockey season in full swing, some students resort to social media like Facebook to get themselves a ticket. Many students have logged onto Facebook in an attempt to purchase or sell tickets to the games. Students may have been selling them for some pretty high prices, which some students don't necessarily like considering they can get them for free. When asking students how they feel, many agree it's not the best thing to do, but sometimes students will pay the price to go to the game.
I think it comes down to the people who are trying to take advantage of an advantage they have. I personally feel, you know, neutral towards it. If they want to sell them for money and give the tickets to someone else for, say, $10 on Facebook, then that's okay.
I think it gets ridiculous when they would sell a ticket for like $50. I can get like, okay, maybe 5 or 10 because that's what like the general tickets are sold for, but $50 is a little too much. But I do know how desperate people can get during the Yale game. I almost bought one, but then I ended up winning one.
Seems like students will do just about anything to see the Bobcats play. From Q30 News, I'm Kayla Heavey.
Local news from around Connecticut is up next,
including a special visit from one of Q30's four-legged friends. Stay with us.
Running an animal shelter without proper funding and resources is hard.
But Sean Klasby tells us how one North Haven shelter manages to keep the doors open.
The Humane Society estimates that 3 million cats and dogs are killed each year in shelters. 80% of those animals are healthy and available for adoption. So this North Haven animal shelter is doing everything they can to make sure their animals do not become part of those numbers.
This dog is certainly happy to see my camera, because right now he's alone and waiting to be adopted. The Animal Haven Shelter is nestled into a quiet North Haven neighborhood. Shelter rescues animals from New York who are in danger of being euthanized, but they mostly serve the local area. It's not uncommon for them to take in animals right off the street.
One time somebody left a mama with kittens. It was about 100 degrees, one of the hottest days of the year, in Tupperware.
According to the American Society for the Prevention of Animal Cruelty, also known as the ASPCA, roughly 2.7 million animals are euthanized each year. That's 1.2 million dogs and 1.4 million cats.
A no-kill animal shelter means that everything that we accept in our facility, we have a mission to not put it to sleep unless it's ill and suffering.
As a no-kill shelter, these little guys are not euthanized. But not euthanizing the animals does come at a cost.
We only have a certain amount of space.
The lack of space is just one of several roadblocks.
We don't get any funding whatsoever, so we ask for donations, and that's how we keep ourselves alive.
The team is willing to tackle these challenges head on because of their love for animals.
I don't want to be someone who just arbitrarily thinks, oh, it's okay to just toss life away like that. I mean, I just don't think it's right.
In North Haven, Sean Klasby, Q30 News.
Now for more local headlines, including the tragic death of a hiker in New Haven.
Daniel Keith is the latest. Daniel?
Thanks, guys. A Hamden man died after a fatal hiking accident in New Haven. 26-year-old Robert Anastasio was found dead at West Rock Ridge State Park on Sunday evening. Police responded to a 911 call from witnesses who say that they saw a man fall hundreds of feet off of a cliff. Firefighters located the body and immediately determined that the man had died. With almost no light to work with, rescue efforts to uncover the body did not begin until the following morning. At this time, New Haven police are ruling out the possibility of foul play. 17 schools in Fairfield were placed on lockdown after at least three of the district's schools received threatening phone calls. Police from several counties, including Bridgeport, Newtown, Westport, and Easton, responded to the threats of guns and pipe bombs being brought into the schools. One elementary school and two high schools received the threats, but police say an additional one or two schools might have received the calls as well. All school activities, including home and away sporting events, were canceled for the day. Police have yet to identify a suspect as the investigation continues. One 17-year-old Hamden boy got a little more than he had hoped for after joyriding in a stolen vehicle. It happened around 9 a.m. last Friday when police attempted to pull the teen over after running a red light in New Haven. After refusing to stop, an officer on a motorcycle tried to get in front of the vehicle but was run over and suffered an injury to his shoulder. The vehicle was reported stolen from Hamden only 3 days before the pursuit, and police say that the teen does not have a license. The teen is being charged with larceny, assaulting an officer, reckless driving, and several moving violations. And finally, Hamden police arrested a New Haven teen in connection with a burglary that occurred in August. 18-year-old Dontell Littlejohn was arrested last week in connection with the burglary on Mill Rock Road on August 24th. Police say that Littlejohn had stolen a flat-screen television along with other electronics while the residents slept. Police first confronted Littlejohn moments after the incident, but further investigation led to his arrest last week. Littlejohn is being charged with burglary, larceny, and criminal mischief. He's being held on $50,000 bond. And that's it for your local news. Now, back to the desk.
Thanks, Daniel. The rain's certainly been coming down hard today, but what's in store for the rest of the week?
For that, we turn to Dora Labatt. Dora, what's it looking like out there?
Well, guys, it's raining, it's windy, but at least it's not a hurricane. At least, I really hope you guys have your ponchos, your raincoats, and your umbrellas ready. But eventually, it will get sunny for the rest of the week, so there is hope. We'll be right back and I'll tell you a little more about it.
Welcome to A Sheer Sensation, North Haven's premier cosmetology service, located at 140 Washington Avenue, minutes from Hamden. We offer an array of services from basic cuts and colors to lash extensions and formaldehyde free keratin treatments. We also provide hair chalk and styling for men. When you spend $60, your Q card will get you 10% off. Call us at 203-239-6477 to make your next appointment at A Sheer Sensation.
My name is Doug Thoreau. For nearly 90 years, three generations of my family have been providing the highest quality repair service. Insurance companies will refer car owners to lesser quality shops to save money. At Thoreau Auto Body, we provide the highest quality repairs with a lifetime guarantee to maintain the safety and value of your car. That's the quality you deserve. Thoreau Auto Body, our best work goes unnoticed.
Welcome to Joya Spa and Salon in Hamden. Whether you want a new look or the perfect wedding day hair, come to us for complete hair and nail care. Cuts, styles, updos, extensions, and beautiful dimensional hair color, as well as manis and pedis, acrylics, gels, and shellac. Treat yourself to a facial, a peel, or microdermabrasion. Relax with a variety of massage techniques, including Swedish and hot stone massage. Joya Spa and Salon. Call today.
Welcome back.
Hey, take camera three. Start weather.
Oh, welcome back. As for our current temperatures in the tri-state area, we have Buffalo at 63 degrees, New York at 66 degrees, Washington at 70 degrees, and Pittsburgh at 64. As for today's temperatures in Connecticut, we have Hartford at 56 degrees, Meriden at 69, and New Haven at 61. So it is a little bit warmer than it was last week. As for tonight's forecast, it's 58 degrees outside, a little chilly, and if you've been out there, you've experienced the heavy rain, and yes, 100% chance of rain because it's already raining. As for tomorrow's temperatures in Connecticut, we have Hartford at 71 degrees, Meriden at 72 degrees, and New Haven at 70 degrees, so it will be a little bit warmer. However, we will have AM rain, and there's a 60% chance of rain throughout the day at 71 degrees, so it is going to be warmer. As for the seven-day forecast, we have Thursday, which is tomorrow, 71 degrees, as I just said. Friday, it's going to be a little cloudy, and temperatures are going to drop to 59 degrees. There's a chance that it will be 31 degrees. That is the low chance. And as for Saturday and Sunday, Saturday will be cloudy and 55 degrees. Low temperature is 41 degrees. So it is getting chilly as it is fall. And Sunday, we have a high chance of rain. So again, get your ponchos and umbrellas ready. And as for next week, Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, we will be in the 60s, so it will be a little bit warmer, but brace yourselves, rain might still come. That's it for your full weather forecast. Now back to the desk.
Thank you, Dora. Award-winning director and producer Linda Mendoza visited Quinnipiac this past week. She presented her one-woman comedy show, Cursed, My Road to Hollywood.
Q30's Kelly Novak sat down for an exclusive interview with Mendoza to talk about her rise to the top in an industry filled with hurdles.
Award-winning television director Linda Mendoza has collaborated with many well-known actors.
I have worked with Tina, I have worked with Andy, I've worked with Will Ferrell, America Ferrara, Lawrence Fishburne, Richard Dreyfuss, Chris Rock.
But being on a first-name basis with Tina Fey, Andy Samberg, and other members of Hollywood's elite wasn't her intention.
I never planned on being in the television industry. I mean, I literally fell into it.
A sociology major from Detroit, Mendoza was given the chance to work for a record company at its Los Angeles location in her third year of college. But record sales didn't thrive for long.
The record business, as we all know, started to really take a major tumble in the early 80s. And my store started to close and, you know, we were closing stores all over.
Desperate for income, Mendoza used her connections to secure her very first job in television.
I had a very dear friend from Detroit who had another friend, it's all about who you know, who said, hey, they're looking for pages at Metro Media, Channel 11. You know, I'm sure I could get you in. And I had no idea what that meant, but Lord knows I needed a job. And so I went and I got hired working as a page like Kenneth from 30 Rock, if anybody knows that.
After her brief stint at Metro Media, Mendoza was put into contact with a commercial director and worked as his production assistant. This helped her realize she wanted to continue on this career path.
That's really, I would say, when my interest peaked in television.
A few years later, she was introduced to Bruce Gowers, a prominent TV director famously known for directing Queen's Bohemian Rhapsody music video. It was Gowers who truly helped her learn the tricks of the trade.
So I became his assistant, and I worked with Bruce for 13 years, and that's really where I started to learn really about content and production and what it means to really be a director.
Check out the full interview at Q30Television.com.
And now, from President Obama's recognition of the U.S. women's soccer team to Adele's comeback, dropping her new song, Hello.
Kelly Ryan has this week's entertainment news. Kelly?
Thanks, guys. American Idol Season 11 winner Phillip Phillips tied the knot this past weekend. Phillips and his longtime girlfriend, Hannah Blackwell, were introduced by Phillips' sister 7 years ago. Phillips popped the question last year on Christmas Eve. The couple got hitched at the Rosora Plantation in Albany, Georgia. Phillips and his bride planned a Southern-style wedding, and 250 of their closest friends and family witnessed their marriage. And late-night host Jimmy Fallon took a spill on Saturday night, injuring himself for the second time. Only a few months ago, Fallon was sent to the hospital for hurting his left hand. He had fallen in his kitchen after tripping over a rug. His wedding ring got caught on a countertop, virtually pulling off his finger. However, this time, the injury happened on his other hand. Fallon was being honored by the Harvard Lampoon on Saturday. He was reaching for a bottle of Jaeger from the crowd. With a purple bandage still wrapped around the originally injured finger, Fallon then managed to trip over a kneeling person. His bottle cut his hand, sending him to the emergency room once again. Multiple jokes have been made about the TV show host, one especially hilarious comment being, "Help, I'm fallen and I can't get up." Fallon has been crowned the king of klutzes. President Barack Obama honored the women's U.S. soccer team yesterday at the White House for their World Cup success. Obama shared that the soccer team has inspired millions of girls to dream bigger while simultaneously encouraging boys to look at girls differently in the face of sports. Bystanders chuckled when the president said that the women's soccer team, quote, taught all America's children that playing like a girl means you're a badass, end quote. The women's team defeated Japan 5-2 in the World Cup for the first time in 16 years.
the women's coach even presented the president with a soccer jersey, customized with his name and the number 44. The entire team then took a selfie with Obama. And finally, Grammy Award winner Adele recently announced that her third killer album, 25, will be released on November 20th. A single from her album, titled Hello, was released this week and has received positive feedback across the board. The song was nicknamed A Mighty Comeback by DigitalSpy.com. The day after the album is released, the soul artist will appear on Saturday Night Live as a musical guest. This will be the first time Adele has performed on the show since her SNL debut in 2008. That's all for your entertainment news. I'm Kelly Ryan. Back to you at the desk.
Coming up on Q30, the latest on Bobcat sports action,
including your top five Quinnipiac sports plays.
Stay with us.
We are your source for entertainment news.
Laser Medica Derma Centers is a new philosophy in skincare for all ages. We are dedicated to offering the most technologically advanced and least invasive skincare treatments. Show your Q card and receive 20% off any procedure. We also provide microdermabrasion and Botox treatments, all performed in a relaxing spa environment. We are conveniently located at 52 Washington Avenue in North Haven, just down the street from Quinnipiac's North Haven campus. Call to schedule a free consultation and find out how Laser Medica can give you smooth, sexy skin all year long.
Now John Franklin is here to tell us about QU Athletics.
How's it going this week, John?
Thanks, guys. Fall sports are coming to a thrilling end here in Hamden. The women's soccer team took on Siena today to determine which team would take the final spot in the MAC postseason tournament. The Saints jumped out to an early 1-0 lead on the back of Madison Vasquez's goal and would not hold back. Siena dominated possession the entire game, and the Saints would bury one more goal, and with it went the hopes of Quinnipiac's postseason run. Senior goalkeeper Natalie Grotsky finished her career fifth all-time in saves for Quinnipiac with 216. Similarly, the Bobcats field hockey team is in a fight for home field advantage in the MAC postseason tournament. Quinnipiac entered the weekend undefeated in MAC play. The Bobcats took to the road to face the Bronx of Ryder. Ryder held a two-goal lead with just 5 minutes to play. Then, junior forward Savannah Riley netted two goals with no time on the clock to send the contest to overtime. In overtime, freshman Dana Barlow buried a goal just 47 seconds in. Quinnipiac went on to face Monmouth 2 days later in Long Branch, New Jersey. The Bobcats would lose the game 3-1 and now will have a game against Fairfield on November 1st. The Bobcats are currently tied for first in the MAC with Monmouth. The winner of the MAC regular season will get to host the postseason tournament. Now guys, let's kick it to the top five plays of the week, brought to you by some Quinnipiac athletes. Let's go to number five, where Rashawn Daly is going to take the ball at the top of the box and hit a rifle, but it's saved by Fairfield goalie Matt Turner. The game will end tied 0-0. Number four, Yale junior Krista Yipchuk dangles not one, two, but three defenders to set up a goal. Quinnipiac would go on to win the game 6-3. And now over to men's hockey for number three, where shorthanded Soren Janssen's going to field a pass, and he's going to say, "Call me Thor," and bury the puck in the back of the net. Quinnipiac would go on to win the game 4-1. And number two, here we have women's field hockey, where Savannah Riley is going to pass up top, like I said, to Dana Barlow, and she's going to bury it past the sliding goalkeeper to give Quinnipiac the win in overtime against the Ryder Bronx. And now the number one play of the week, brought to you by Devon Taves. He's going to chip a defender, say, "Don't mind if I do," and bury the puck in the back of the net. Let's take a second look at that one. Puck chipped over the defender, and he says, "Hey, if you're going to give it to me, I'm going to go five hole." Thanks, guys. Let's take it back to the desk.
Thanks, John. And some big-name people are getting in the Halloween spirit.
Or at least their faces are.
Artists are painting the faces of celebrities like Betty White, Oprah Winfrey, Kanye West, Kim Jong-un, and Miley Cyrus on pumpkins.
The fad, which is called pumpkinsing, is getting bigger and bigger as the 31st gets closer. Literally, the artist even painted a 371-pound pumpkin with Donald Trump's face.
That's all for this week's Q30 Newscast.
Stay up on all the Quinnipiac news on Twitter at Q30 News.
Thanks for watching. I'm Brenna Oracoli.
And I'm Zach Blanchard. Good night.